I opposed genuinely and effectively. I was in the forefront of the opposition to Ayub Khan's dictatorship and to Yahya Khan's dictatorship. These friends of ours who are making these statements at that time, they were not at all critical of Yahya Khan or of Ayub Khan, but certainly not of Yahya Khan. They hailed his constitution when he was going to give his own constitution. I was the only one who opposed it. And so this is not correct. The point is that unfortunately our society, and I don't exclude you from it, is such that either people want too much government or they want no government. It's a question of attaining that necessary balance which is essential for democracy. And democracy calls for more discipline than a dictatorship. In a dictatorship, discipline is imposed on society. In a democracy, it is a self-restraint exercise of discipline. Now the point is that our friends become democratic when it is only there to accuse the government, that government is being oppressive, government is taking away civil liberties. But when they get on the platform or when they are in a position to demonstrate their respect for democracy, how do they demonstrate it? I'll leave aside everything else. I give you today's instance. I had invited the whole opposition for dinner. I invited them all. The National Assembly, members of the National Assembly without exception, members of the Senate without exception. They have said that we are not coming to the Senate.
The whole opposition.
Now, what do you expect? Then, the kind of speeches they make, that we will break down the walls of the presidency, that we will take him by the neck and we'll tear him to pieces. What is the army doing? Why is the army not coming into politics? Why is the army not intervening? Why are they not coming to play their role, which we expect of them? If there's a coup d'etat in Greece, they banner headline it as if there has been Diwali in their homes. The point is that their own approach to democracy, their own concept of democracy is completely lopsided. And I pity them. I feel sorry for them. I feel sorry for their political acumen, for their inability to comprehend how the modern world ticks. It's not true. I would like to see that the roots of democracy are spread and that we don't ever again have to see dictatorship and to see juntas. We've had enough of all that. And you know, for me, how is it in any way, for my party, for me, how is democracy in any way a danger or it's a threat? We are in government, we'll hold elections, and if we go into the opposition, still it'll be the youngest party, it'll have the youngest leadership, it'll again be able to come back into office again. But if we spread the influences of dictatorship, it doesn't serve the purpose of my party or serve our purpose. So even if you look at it from that very limited angle, and I never look at problems from a limited angle, I look at them from the broad national spectrum, it does not suit us to throttle democracy. But you know, it is the opposition also which has to strengthen democracy. And in sometimes the opposition has a bigger role to show tolerance and understanding.
So what about this happenings in end of this Balochistan? How serious there? Because I was talking to Governor Bukti, and he said insurgency was increasing, the area of insurgency was increasing day by day. How far he is correct, I don't know. But this was his, he went on record to say that.
But now you see, now this in itself will show you that either my faith in democracy is very great, or that there must be something very supremely tolerant about me, because Governor Bukti, as governor, has said things which in India no governor would have dared to speak. I know you had a 3-hour interview with him, or 3.5 hours.
I thought he must have said before.
This has become his favorite word, insurgency. And Governor Bukti is going through his own a crisis of his own outlook. And you can imagine now that how I deal with our political friends and others, because he has been giving out to the BBC and others the most fantastic kind of stories. Yet he sees me, he meets me, I don't reprimand him for it, and I know that he says things which, as I said, in your country you would not tolerate from any provincial government or from any provincial governor. This in itself demonstrates our faith in democracy and our concept of tolerance. Secondly, it also shows that the Balochistan situation is not a critical situation, because if it was a critical situation, I would not have taken the chance of allowing Governor Bhutto to indulge in anomalous and kind of behavior. I would have said the situation is so critical, we are on the verge of insurgency, or an insurgency is taking place, and this man from the seat of government is speaking like this. Let us therefore replace him and do something. But the position is being brought under control, position is being satisfactorily brought under control, and I am not making any predictions, but I can tell you that confidently we will be able to resolve the problem of Balochistan. And when I say resolve it, I don't mean by force. We will be able to resolve it by the only means, which is by political means, and that army operations, if they are taking place there, will no longer be needed in the near future. And the army operations are limited and confined to a very small area. It is in the Mengal area and the Mari area, firstly. Secondly, like you hear other tales, all manner of exaggerated stories are going out. That, you know, our people don't know what a division means. Sometimes you hear it, four divisions are operating in Balochistan.
I was told that.
Sometimes you're told five divisions are operating in Balochistan. Now, you have been a journalist for a long time. You know what a division is. With our Afghan problem, with our some of our forces on the border, I tell you to put two and two together and see whether we can even afford to have a one division in Balochistan. So, you know, our people are fond of exaggeration. And they will tell you thousands of people have died, nothing of the kind. This has not been indiscriminate kind of operation. It has. We have made it very clear that the army is not to resort to action. It is to resort to only self-defense measures. It is not to chase people, to shoot or kill indiscriminately. As a result of it, there have been some army casualties as a result of this policy. But I am not going to be foolish enough and to carry out any kind of operations in Balochistan which would be which would alienate the people. And now the Sardars are coming. They are, I won't use the word surrender. Bhutto used to at one time publicize the way others are coming to surrender to him. I am too small a man to use words of like surrender and lay down arms. They are coming. They are coming to cooperate with the government. We are allowing them to come and cooperate with the government. And as I say, that sooner than most people expect, this thing is going to be neatly packed up in and solved, I hope, forever.
Is there any such similar problem in NWFP, anything?
Not of this nature, but it is there linked with the problem of Balochistan. Once the Balochistan problem is solved, and I hope and I pray to God that we will solve it in the near future, it will in itself will defuse to a great extent the situation in NWFP. Of course, now it's in the world of today, a firecracker, a thing thrown here and there. There's not a single place in the world where you don't have that kind of thing. Even in your own country, this kind of thing takes place. People have got toys, people have got things. Now, what do you do? This can also come to an end if we take repressive measures. I don't want to take repressive measures. Firecrackers and grenades can be thrown into the houses of opposition also, if they throw in the houses of... We are not doing that. But, you know, it's a funny game to play. It's a stupid game to play. And therefore, we are taking it in a calm and a restrained manner. It's not an organized thing. It's not a thing that the people are in revolt. It's not that the people are disillusioned. That's not the position. There is this little bit students here, some so-called militia. We have now recently taken steps to ban all private armies, and to show our good intentions, we are going to also impose the ban on our own people's guards. We have passed the other law, which is against sedition and anti-state activities, about talk about five nationalities and 20 nationalities. So we are consolidating. and we are consolidating all the time. But I dare say that if you come back 6 months from now, you'll hear more criticism against the government. If you come back a year later, you'll hear still
more. I have heard this time against you.
Yes, yes.
Personally.
I am the villain. So the next time it will be even more. But every by-election we have won. We have not lost a single by-election. And if they tell you that by-elections are being rigged, there's a by-election on Sunday in Lahore. Now, in a city like Lahore, which is in the heart of Lahore, we can't rig a by-election. And if you think that we are rigging them, I'll ask you to stay on till Sunday. See the But the question is this, that everywhere, wherever the elections have been held, we have been winning the elections. Mm-hmm. And people have, by and large, the masses repose confidence. The opposition is in disarray. They are in complete disarray. Firstly, because we have genuinely brought about many changes in the country. We have consolidated national unity. We have got the economy again moving. And in addition to that, their own stupidities and their lack of comprehension of the way opposition should function.
I think I've taken just one or two more questions, and that one, it's very much, I would say, here I've heard that you would like to form a coalition at the center and in the states. Is there any truth?
No, I have not said that, and nor have I got that in my mind. In political negotiations, I don't believe that you should go with preconceived and fixed views. The general principles of national unity, and finding a viable and a credible political settlement. Now, we are then prepared to discuss anything from one end of the spectrum to the other.
Are you thinking of having negotiations or any talks with them?
I will not say this thing any more than what I have said, that I am going to be able to resolve this matter. This invitation to dinner, if they had any sense, they would have accepted.
It was another branch.
It was a curtain raiser. But they don't understand these things.
Because they were talking to them, they said that we are being driven to the wall and anything can happen.
But if anything
can happen, but I'm
but driven, if your back is to the wall, you would accept the invitation. I mean, the point is, it's self-evident that they should have said, they should have thought, why is he inviting us at this time? It's not because I would like to sit and have dinner with them. And there was a purpose, but they don't see these bigger things. And then they say, our people are in jail, how can we go, how can we, until our demands are accepted. You don't accept demands like that. You don't say, well, these are our demands, and you accept them, and they don't know. The demands and counter demands are negotiated, discussed, a settlement is reached.
Saying anything can happen, but the question which one we ask on the side and one asks here, after Bhutto, who?
Well, so many. Why not?
I see. You have established that kind of.
I don't believe that there is a vacuum in any society of that nature. Of course, setbacks can take place and. There can be some difficult days for a country. Well, the question used to be asked after Nehru, who, and then there was Shastri, and then there is Mrs. Gandhi.
You didn't have unbroken tradition of democracy. I'm saying you didn't have for 14 years. So that is what I'm saying. It's still very young.
I don't see it in the opposition because they are not the men of that caliber. They are not the men of that type who would be able to bring about national cohesion. Yes. And now, for instance, to say a stupid thing like this, that we are selling oil to the United States, the oil began. Now, which sensible leader of the opposition would make a statement like that? You know, when we were in the opposition, so often people used to come, small timers, they say, you know, we can make capital out of this and that. And there are certain things you just don't do. But that kind of thing does not breed leaders. And I had hoped that Wali Khan, for instance, would offer a viable leadership, but I find him to be terribly erratic. And not only terribly erratic, but indulging in hallucinations and all kinds of imaginary stories. You know, he makes up his mind that something is true, he repeats it two or three times, and then he believes that that is true. about, for instance, this attempt on his life. He knows, I'm sure, in his heart of heart.